Wall Street Memes Casino.
I'm fine.
And Sportsbook.
This is Colin McGuigan for IFL TV. Delighted to be joined by Dan Raphael in Las Vegas. Dan, this is actually our first ever IFL, and these normally got you unlocked. So you've been let off the leash from Andrew McCart this week. We're in Vegas. Big fight feel for Canelo Munguia?
Oh yeah. I mean, anytime the biggest star in the game gets into the ring, it's a big deal. And when he gets into the ring with a fighter that you A, expect to be an exciting fight, and B, a fight that some people expect will be highly competitive, that makes it a big deal to me.
How do you think Canelo approaches this against Munguia? A lot of people maybe see Canelo taking Munguia out early. I believe it's actually going to be a bit of nip and tuck for the first six rounds. How do you see it?
I tend to agree with what you said. I think that Munguia is in this fight certainly early on, just because of the youthful aggressiveness and the, you know, his own excitement to be in the fight and being able to follow the plan. But at some point, you know, when he does start to feel the punches, because let's face it, he gets hit, and Canelo is a good puncher, and he also lands hard punches, that's going to take its toll at some point. But I think for the first few rounds, I think we got a real fight on our hands. I think when it gets to maybe the second half, then it becomes perhaps more of a where the levels separate themselves. Because as good as you may think Munguia is, and I think he's very good, I think that Canelo is still on another level.
Munguia is a front foot fighter, someone that comes to engage in war. Second fight with Freddie Roach, who's obviously an offensive minded coach. Do you believe that Munguia has the ability to take Canelo out?
I mean, look, it's boxing, and if you're a good puncher and you land the right way, anybody can get knocked out. But in over 60 plus fights, I've seen Canelo Alvarez hurt exactly once. I was actually at the fight here at the MGM. We're in the press room at the MGM Grand. That fight was here in this arena on an undercard. It was wasn't his first American fight, but it was first like fight in front of on a big pay-per-view and on a big card. And he was fighting against Miguel Cotto's older brother, Jose Miguel Cotto. And at the end of the first round, he got clipped. And he's lucky that the round was over, because if the fight was another, or the round was another, like say 15, 20 seconds, he might have been out. He was badly hurt. And there was a lot of hype around Canelo going into that particular appearance, because he had so much hype coming out of Mexico, and he had some smaller American fights and such. And a lot of the media were seeing him for the first time. I had seen a few of his other fights, but we were watching this. And I think the general consensus was afterwards, when he got buzzed like that, real, real, real bad. He ended up winning the fight against Cotto. But the thought was like, what's all the hype about? This guy's got no chin. He's not going to – how can you get nailed by a guy like that who was a smaller fighter, was coming up in weight, and he did that kind of damage in the first round? That's the last time I saw Canelo ever hurt. That's almost like – I mean, how many years ago is that? That's 15 years ago? I don't know what it's been, almost 20 years, whatever. It's been a heck of a long time. He's got one of the great chins in boxing. A guy went 24 rounds with Triple G, who was an incredible puncher, never showed any signs of being in any kind of serious trouble against a guy that can punch like that. And he's fought other quality punchers who can land big shots. Alfredo Angulo comes to mind, for example. I mean, there's others, and he's never wavered. So you say, can Munguia knock him out? You know, of course he can if he lands the right way, but let's call it the preponderance of the evidence would suggest that with the chin that he's always shown, it's going to be really hard.
Dan, Canelo hasn't had a knockout victory in around about 3 years now. Do you think that this fight more than likely goes the distance, and Canelo probably wears him down and has an opportunity to take him out towards the end, and it's up to him whether he does it or not?
I think this fight, of all the recent fights that he has had, lends itself more for him to be able to score a knockout than the other ones. I think a lot of people thought he might be able to take out John Ryder. That was a little surprising that Ryder went 12, and that's one of the reasons, frankly, I believe that Jaime Munguia got this fight, is because everybody was comparing the fact that, you know, Canelo dropped him, but he went 12 rounds with him, and Munguia dropped him 4 times and stopped him in the 9th round. And so when there are people comparing direct competition, you know, one fight apart from each other, you know, Munguia sort of showed himself like, not to say he's better than Canelo, but he certainly outdid him against a common opponent. Not that that means anything when they get in the ring with each other. So other than Canelo not scoring the knockout against Ryder, you know, Charlo was there to survive. So you got to take what you can get. The third fight with Golovkin, who's also got a great chin, that didn't surprise me at all that fight went 12 rounds. That was my pick, 12-round decision for Canelo. And if you go back before that, I mean, even in the Bivol fight, I never in a million years expected that even if you pick Canelo to win the fight, I didn't think he'd stop in Bivol. So my point is, there hasn't been a fight other than Ryder in the last number of fights. And before that, you know, he stopped Plant and he stopped Saunders, you know, those types of fighters. So this is the first time in a bit where I think, because of the amount of punches that Munguia typically gets hit with, that if there's going to be a fight where you can lend itself to a pick of Canelo by knockout, certainly this would be it.
I asked Canelo yesterday his thoughts on Oscar De La Hoya coming for Eddie Hearn. He said that he wasn't too aware of the exact comments that Oscar made, but he said that Oscar's full of shit. What do you think of Oscar and Eddie's beef? And it seems to be that Eddie's kind of taken the more mature role in this for once.
Listen, to me, it's showbiz. I mean, it's just the two guys, they know how to get under each other's skin. It's for show. It's, I mean, there's certainly healthy competition there just because they compete for the attention of the fans and the media, and also for the contracts with fighters and that sort of thing. But they're both great promoters. They both have healthy businesses. They've both done great jobs with their companies. I mean, they've all had their different issues here and there. So I don't take it too seriously. And I've known Oscar for 25 years, both as a fighter and as a promoter. And, you know, he knows how to get his point across when he wants to. And certainly I've known Eddie as long as he's been, on the scene in a major way. He can do the same. So I think it's more just for YouTube hits, let's say, and just for fun than anything real serious.
On the Ariel Helwani show, Oscar said he wouldn't hold back this week when it came to, you know, speaking to Canelo at the press conference. He said that he won't hold back. What do you make of that? And do you believe that there is going to be a little bit of back and forth between them today?
You know, it's going to hype up the fight because, listen, Munguia is never going to say a negative word. He's a very humble, very nice guy. He doesn't really shit talk. If you ever watch any of his fights, I've never heard him say a bad word about his opponent ever. And it's business. You want to get the most buys possible. How do you get people hyped up? There's a lot of talking. And if the fighter's not going to do it, somebody else has got to take that reign. And Oscar is certainly able to dish it out. And there is legitimate beef between Oscar and Canelo. You know, Canelo, I had an interview with Canelo that we played on our podcast a few days ago that's available, where I asked him he's fighting an undefeated fighter, Munguia. You know, is there added motivation to taking out an undefeated fighter? Because he's beaten a lot of undefeated fighters. Like, you know, it's always an extra special thing to do that. I said, what about the opportunity not only to do that, but to take out a fighter that's, one of the top guys in Oscar's stable, who obviously you guys don't have a very good relationship. And he kind of hemmed and hawed a little bit. And then when I kind of pressed him a little bit, he says, yeah, it would make him feel better to do that. So, you know, Canelo wants to have that dig the knife in a little bit more if he can take out Munguia. Forget about a decision. If he can knock him out, that'll make him feel good in terms of his beef with De La Hoya. So, yeah, I hope Oscar shit talks a little. I hope they shit talk a little bit to make it interesting. Because if you watch the kickoff press conference where Jaime and Canelo met, it was a good press conference, but there was no heat. They were so nice. No time to be nice during fight week.
Last one for me. I know you're a busy man today, but there's been a bit of beef between Tank and Floyd Mayweather. What do you know about this? And is Floyd Mayweather actually detained in Dubai at the moment?
Well, I mean, they don't have a promotional relationship anymore. I mean, his Mayweather Promotions is no longer involved with his career, as far as I know anyway. It's now Gervonta has his own company that's a business, you know, maneuver where you has a Gervonta, you know, what is it, Tank, Gervonta Tank Promotions, or I don't know what it's called. Yeah. Now, he still has a close relationship with Leonard Ellerbe. Now, Leonard is the CEO of Mayweather Promotions, but when he is involved in the fights that Gervonta does, he's not there representing Mayweather Promotions. He's representing Gervonta as like his guy, Leonard Ellerbe. You don't see the Mayweather Promotions in the press releases. You don't see it on the signage. They don't mention it when they bring him up to the podium. He's doing it because they have a long history together. But Floyd and Gervonta they don't have a good relationship. I mean, it stems from, this is not a secret. I'm not the first one to say this. Everybody knows that there was a situation, however long ago it was, where Gervonta slept with Floyd's daughter. That caused an issue, understandably, right? And that's been, I believe, the genesis and is the base of why all this has happened. And if they're no longer involved on a business basis and neither one can make money for the other guy, they don't need or want each other. And they both are very dug in on their positions. They both have very strong personalities. Look, I covered Floyd's entire championship career. I know how stubborn and how outspoken he can be. I mean, he can be super nice and cordial and kind also. And I've seen Gervonta both ways as well. But when it comes to the friction between them, they clearly don't hold back.
Do you believe that that relationship's repairable? You know both guys pretty well. Do you believe it's repairable?
I think every relationship in boxing is repairable. I mean, who would have ever thought that we would see? I mean, there was a time where Oscar De La Hoya with Golden Boy and Top Rank and Bob Arum were as bitter and mortal enemies as there could be, fighting over the Pacquiao contract. We in the business referred to it for years as the Cold War. Now they like hang out with each other, like they had dinner with each other, they're doing business with each other, they're fights, you know, they're making fights together when it makes sense. So is it, you asked the question, is it repairable? Yes, of course, it's business.
Well, Dan, it's always a pleasure on IFL TV. Maybe catch up again this week. Really appreciate your time as always, and it was good to get you away from Andy for once.
My pleasure.
Wall Street Memes Casino.
I'm fine.
And Sportsbook.